Vaidehi. You might have heard about linked lists, or you might think that you're supposed to know about them. Or maybe you do know a little bit about them, but don't know why you should care or why they matter. Either way, I want to tell you about why they're so cool, and hopefully by the end of this video, you'll find them as fascinating as I do. So I think the first thing to understanding linked lists is knowing that they're just a type of data structure. A linked list is a data structure that is traversed linearly. Here are a couple of elements that could be inside of any linear data structure. They're connected like this. Note that in order to get to this last element, we have to start here and work our way over. In a nonlinear data structure, that's not necessarily the case. One element could be connected to another in several different ways. You're probably already familiar with a couple different types of linear data structures and nonlinear data structures. But the most important thing to know is that linear data structures can only be traversed sequentially. So we might not always realize it, but we deal with linear and nonlinear data structures all the time. If you've ever worked in a programming language and used hashes, or sometimes they're called dictionaries, you're really dealing with a nonlinear data structure. Similarly, if you've ever used a tree or worked on a graph, that's also a nonlinear data structure. All of these are nonlinear because order doesn't really matter in any of these objects. However, if you've ever worked with arrays, you know that order really does matter. Arrays have indices, and where you put something in an array is pretty important. There's generally some sort of order and sequence to it. An array is a linear data structure. And it can be helpful to think about arrays when we're learning about linked lists because they're somewhat similar. The biggest differentiator between linked lists and arrays are how they use memory and how they allocate and manage memory in our machines. So if you've ever used a dynamically typed language like Ruby or JavaScript or Python, you probably don't have to worry about how much memory your array is taking up. But just because you don't have to worry about it doesn't mean that it's not happening. It's just been abstracted away. When it comes to linked lists and implementing them, the way that memory is managed is a huge factor in what separates them from something like arrays. Let's say that one byte of used memory is represented by one of these purple squares. Imagine that we had 7 letters that we needed to store in an array. Maybe we need 7 bytes to represent that. An array would need to know how much memory to allocate before we can create it. So if we need 7 bytes of memory, we need to allocate 7 of these squares. So here's our array representation. Arrays need a contiguous block of memory in order to allocate space for whatever it is that you're trying to represent. This is also referred to as a static data structure. Linked lists, on the other hand, don't need all of its resources to be created when a structure is allocating memory. We can grow and shrink our linked lists as needed. If we wanted to represent 7 bytes, we wouldn't need to allocate all the space ahead of time. We could add elements as necessary and allocate more space whenever we needed it. This means that we don't need all of our data to be stored in one place. Arrays need a static amount of memory, but linked lists can grow and shrink dynamically, making them dynamic data structures. Now we're starting to see some differences between arrays, which are static data structures, and linked lists, which are dynamic. They're both linear, but obviously they have their differences. So this makes us wonder, what makes a linked list so special that it can grow dynamically in size? Well, in order to answer that question, we need to understand how a linked list is structured and what are the different parts. There are 2 nodes that are particularly interesting in a linked list. The first node is what we call the head, or the head node. It's the first item in the linked list and it points to the rest of the list. The second node that's pretty important is the last node. The way that we know that we've hit the end of a linked list is when we come to a node that has a pointer to nothing, which is often referred to as null. The last node has a reference to null, and that's how we know we're at the end of the linked list. Let's take a look at one individual node. An individual node is made up of two parts. Those two parts are some sort of data that it contains and a pointer reference. The pointer or reference is how we know which node to go to from this one. And that's pretty much it. A node only has data and a pointer. And that pointer tells us which node comes next in the linked list. What this means is that a single node in a linked list has no idea how big or how small the entire linked list is. Because of this, a linked list doesn't need all of its nodes allocated into the same space. As long as one node knows where the next piece of memory lives, we can traverse through a linked list by just going through one pointer of a node to the next. And this is also part of what makes linked lists different from arrays and why they don't need all of their memory allocated at once. The way that pointers work in linked lists is also a big reason why it's easy to add and remove an element. In an array, you'd have to copy over all the elements, but in a linked list, it's a little bit easier. So now that we know the different parts of a linked list, what are the different types of linked lists we might encounter? Here we have the simplest version of a linked list. This is our singly linked list, where we have a head node, and each node has a pointer to the next one, and we can only go in one direction until we hit a node that references null, which is how we know we've come to the end of the linked list. Here is a slightly more complicated version. This is a doubly linked list. Notice that each node has a reference to both the next node and the previous. Since there are two references, we call it a doubly linked list. There are two directions that you can traverse through this list. You can start here and traverse down to the node that references null, but you can also go back up to the head node where we started from. Here's the more complicated version, which is our circular linked list. There's no null value here at all. Instead, we have a node that acts as the tail. The tail references the first element in the list. So now we know linked lists at their very core aren't actually too complicated. The thing that makes linked lists seem complicated is knowing whether and when to use them. We need to think a little bit about time and space complexity, which is often referred to as Big O notation. The reason that Big O seems to come up a lot is because all the decisions we make as programmers and in dealing with software is a question of efficiency and trade-offs. Big O is often a huge factor in making those big decisions. An easy way to think about it is, how much time does it take for me to do an action? And how much space am I using when I do that action? If you can remember those two things, you can usually figure out the Big O notation of whatever it is that you're trying to do. There are a lot of different ways to classify the Big O notation of a data structure or an algorithm, but for today, we're just really going to concern ourselves with the two that pertain to linked lists. Namely, linear time and constant time. When we say that something has linear time or performs at O of N, Big O notation, what we're really saying is as the input for this function grows, the amount of space and time I need to perform this function grows linearly. By contrast, constant time is basically us saying, no matter how my input grows in size, I need the same amount of time and the same amount of space to do this action. The actions that we're concerned with today are manipulating and handling parts of a linked list, which usually have to do with something in constant time or linear time. Here's another way of looking at constant time versus linear time. Here we can see that with constant time, or O to the 1, no matter how many elements or how much space we need, the amount of time is constant. with linear time, or O of n, as the amount of elements or our input data increases, the operations we need to take will increase linearly. We can compare both of these to another type of function that's very different, which we see right here. This is O of n squared, which is also known as quadratic time. We'll notice that as the elements and our input data increases, the operations that we need to take increase exponentially. It's pretty safe to say that we want to avoid any type of action that's going to take an exponential amount of time. Ideally, we want to look for actions that take a constant amount of time. But with linked lists, sometimes we'll have to deal with linear functions. Here is an example of a linked list. And let's say that we wanted to insert a node to the beginning of the list. There are three pretty simple steps that we'd need to take. First, we'd want to make a new node. Next, we'd want to direct that node's pointer to the current first node in the linked list. Finally, we'd want to take the pointer reference of the head node and rearrange it so that it was pointing at the new node we just added. If we accidentally did step three and directed our head node to the new node before creating this pointer here, we would end up with a cyclical structure and we would lose the rest of this list. So we have to remember to insert this node and set its reference first before changing what the head node points to. We only ever care about the pointers of the head node and the node we inserted. Thus, no matter how big our input is, the amount of time to insert a node at the beginning of the linked list is constant. It's a different story, however, if we want to insert a node to the end of a linked list. In order to do that, we have to start here at our head node. But we don't want to insert anything at the beginning. We're trying to insert it at the end. So we need to traverse through this list until we get to the node that references null. So the first step is to find the last node in the linked list. Once we found it, we can do our pointer rearranging here. We'll need to make sure we create our new node and direct its pointer to null. And once we've done that, we can direct the last node to point at the one we just added. But here's where it gets tricky. If instead of three nodes, say we had 30 or 300 or 3000, we would have to traverse through all of these nodes before we could create and insert this new one. Thus, we really do care about the input size and the size and number of elements in the linked list. This makes inserting a node at the end of a linked list take linear time, since the amount of time and space to perform this action depends on the number of nodes, which is what n is referencing. Inserting an element into a linked list at the beginning is not too terrible. It doesn't even matter how big your linked list is. It's a similar story for deleting from a linked list as well. So imagine if our linked list had 3 million nodes in it and you wanted to delete the last one. We'd have to traverse through all 3 million nodes, and that's probably not the most efficient tool for the job. A good rule of thumb when it comes to linked lists is that they can be really efficient if you want to add or remove an element from the beginning of the list. However, if you want to search and find a single element, depending on the size of your linked list, it can probably be a very poor choice, and you might not want to use it. Let's quickly look at a couple of the ways that arrays and linked lists compare to one another. If we look at how arrays and linked lists compare in terms of insertion and deletion, being able to add an element into an array very quickly can be kind of costly, especially if you need to reallocate a whole lot of memory. Arrays are not very fast at insertion and deletion. We know that if we implement our linked list to make it easy to insert and delete from the beginning of it, then we can do this in constant time, which makes linked lists very fast for insertion and deletion. Because arrays have indexes, it's very easy to search for an item in the array. In order to search through a linked list, you have to potentially search through all the elements, especially if the item you're looking for is at the end of the linked list. Linked lists are not very great for fast element search. Arrays, as we know, are static structures, which means that they are not easy to grow or shrink. Linked lists, on the other hand, are much easier to manipulate and grow, or even shrink. They're dynamic structures. Since it's all just about rearranging some pointers, growing or shrinking our linked list by a lot isn't really something we need to worry about. Similarly, arrays will allocate a contiguous chunk of memory, whereas linked lists don't need to allocate all of its memory at once. Because of the way that arrays are structured with indexes, it's very easy to randomly pull an item from the array. Random access is not allowed in a linked list. Another handy trick with arrays is the fact that it's very easy to run a binary search algorithm through them. Linked lists, on the other hand, because they don't have all of their memory allocated in one place, don't make that very easy. So if you ever find yourself having to do a lot of iteration or searching through your data set, or if you ever need to quickly find a random value, a linked list could be your worst enemy. In those situations, you might want to take advantage of the fact that an array has indexes, is a contiguous block of memory, and is very handy for running algorithms like binary search. On the other hand, if you know that you need to add a whole lot of elements to a data set, and you know that you're not going to need to retrieve them later, then a linked list could be your new best friend. In either case, it's important to know when an array is better and when a linked list might be the right tool for the job. I hope you understand and have a better appreciation for linked lists now. For a little more depth, there's an article that accompanies this video. If you're still unclear, leave a comment or ask a question below. Thanks for watching.